Well, good morning once again. 2 weeks ago, I preached from James chapter 5, where James asked this question: is any of you in trouble? And then he gives us the antidote if we are. He says he should pray. Now, we learn that the word trouble in this context is translated from the Greek, and it means to endure hardship, to endure affliction. James was addressing persecution in the early church, oppression, the many injustices that befell God's people. And these believers were being persecuted for nothing more than being the people of God. This was the trouble that devastated their lives, took their homes, took their incomes, and in many cases, took their very lives. And James's antidote to them was for all of this trouble to just pray. You know, one of the greatest examples or greatest answers to prayer that I have seen in Scripture is in Acts chapter 16. If you remember, Paul and Silas, each day they would go to the place of prayer, and they were met by a slave girl that had a demon. And she every day she would try to counterfeit their ministry. And so one day, Paul spoke right to the demon and said, "In the name of Jesus, I command you to come out of her." And at that point, the slave girl was basically set free. And so, because she earned money for her masters, they didn't like it. So they brought him before the magistrates. And here's what the magistrates did because of that. The crowd joined in this attack against Paul and Silas. And they were ordered to be stripped and beaten. And after they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison. And they were guarded carefully. So all for just praying for this woman. And here's what I want you to see, or here's what I want you to hear. Once these guys were in these stocks, severely beaten and flogged, it says in verse 25 of chapter 16, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. All right, so here they were, strapped, beaten, and in these stocks, and they were praying and singing hymns to God. Now, I don't know what the prayers were. It doesn't say what the prayers were. If it was me, God, get me out of this, right? But here's the result of their prayer. I'm going to skip through all this just to give you the end result. The jailer, eventually, the one that locked them in, brought them into his house and set a meal before them because he was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole family. So here's two guys in trouble, deep in trouble, and they prayed, and they were praising God. And the result of that was not to release them from all their troubles that we saw that they had, but instead their prayers resulted in an eternal healing, salvation for the jailer and his entire family. Didn't free them up like we would have wanted, or maybe even like they wanted. It resulted in something far greater than what they could see, eternal life for one of their captors. To God goes the glory. When we pray for God's will to be done, those are the kind of things that are apt to happen. Not necessarily exactly what we pray for, but something for the glory of God. Trouble hasn't gone anywhere, not 2,000 years ago to today. For the people of God, read the latest copy of the Voice of the Martyrs. You see, in the persecuted church all over this world, they're going through the same persecution as Paul and Silas and many of these believers that James was writing to. Now, Pastor James is addressing another affliction: people who are sick. In the Greek, asthenēo is the term for sick. And it was the people of God who were suffering physically or mentally or emotionally that he was addressing. Those who were feeble, those who were diseased, believers who were without physical strength. And here's what he told them. Read with me here. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. You believe that? Now, when James wrote, "Is any one of you sick?" it was rhetorical, of course, because thousands read this circulated letter around to all these different churches. There were many out of these thousands who would have qualified as being sickly. And now, before we actually break down these four verses, let's address this question. What James wrote to the church in 50 AD regarding prayer and healing, does it still apply to the body of believers? There is no doubt that the subject of healing in the church is one of controversy today. However, there's nothing controversial about all the healings that took place through the pages. There are some who believe what James is referring to here was only for the apostolic period, meaning God had special plans to get his church birthed. And then when the last apostle died, those special gifts died with them. Personally, I don't see anything in Scripture that tells me that. Here's what I see in Scripture. I see things like Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. I see in Luke 10 where Jesus sent out 72 followers. He sent them out to prepare the people, and here's what Jesus told them. He said, "Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God is near." I read things like in Mark, "Then the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it." No doubt, starting from scratch with 12 guys would have taken no small number of miracles to get this thing off the ground so that the world could recognize the mighty power of God and how real it truly is. But don't you think that God knew just how difficult it would be to get the world to recognize that same mighty power of God 2,000 years later? Here's who the Word of God says my God is. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Now, God was compassionate 4,000 years ago. He was compassionate 2,000 years ago, and he's no less compassionate today. So until I hear from the one whose compassions never fail tell me that he's no longer healing the sick through prayer, I'm going to assume he still is. So let's start with the first step of praying for the sick. Call the elders. Why the elders? Good question. Why the elders? It's not because the elders were the super spiritual ones who alone possessed the ability to pray for healing. No. James didn't say call the elders because they got something nobody else got. Didn't say that. The term elder in this context here means elders in the Greek, presbyteros. And it renders those who presided over the assemblies. In other words, church leaders. The New Testament uses the term presbyteros interchangeably with bishops and with pastors and elders. Again, leaders in the church. And I believe that James is referring to elders because they undoubtedly had experience praying for the sick. See, these were brand new, just starting baby churches that James was writing to. The elders would have been the ones who had experienced firsthand this supernatural action of praying for and seeing God heal. And the elders would have known by exactly what power and what authority the sick got healed. They had already been there, and they had already done that with Jesus and with Peter and with John and Paul. But outside of the role in the church, there was nothing then and nothing now special about pastors or elders. You got to be careful. To keep us grounded, Luke wrote this. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. But Peter made him get up. "Stand up," he said. "I'm only a man myself." There are times when people want to esteem church leaders, elevate them, put them on a pedestal in some high regard as though they have some special pipeline to the Lord. That is not true. It's okay to respect their position, and we should, but by elevating anyone above everyone else, you're doing them and you're doing yourself a disservice. Listen, it's not the elders doing the healing, right? Important to keep that in mind when it comes to praying for the sick. Now let me take a moment here and interject something that may suggest why we're not seeing the healing that was once seen through Scripture. We're not seeing these daily miracles today. You know, the elders were more spiritually mature. Many of them would have, as I mentioned, experienced Jesus and the disciples laying hands and praying for healing for people. These men, most likely, the elders, would have followed that same pattern that was shown to them by the apostles. Now, it would have been the spiritually mature who would have been less likely to have given in to the temptation to add or mix in some kind of human performance with this ministry. Praying for healing, just as with any supernatural call of God, can easily turn into a religious spectacle, a spiritual sideshow event, and that's the last thing the Lord ever wanted. Look at every healing Jesus ever did. None of them came with pomp and circumstances. None of them. Wasn't it if Jesus, okay, for my next trick I'm about to do? No, that was not what he said. As a matter of fact, Jesus often directed the people that he healed not to go and tell anyone. Now, I might be stepping on some toes here, but unless you could come up with some scriptural references for some of the things I see going on in the church today, especially when it comes to prayer, laying hands, and healing, I'm going to conclude that much of it is not from God. And if it's not from God, then his power will be missing from it as well. I'm talking about popping somebody on the forehead and watching them fall on the ground. Where did that originate? Seriously. Can't find anywhere Jesus thumping Peter or some other disciple on the head and then declaring, "Be slain in the spirit." Just telling you. I have yet to read that, actually, anywhere in Scripture. And I've yet to have anyone tell me the purpose for doing that. I researched the word slain in the Bible, both in the Greek and the Hebrew. And I can tell you, there's 58 references. And in all 58 of those references to the word slain in the Bible, every one of them refer to killing, murder, or dying, not falling over in euphoria. And I've never heard anyone tell me that they got murdered in the spirit. So, not in there. So there's really no need to be pushed or whacked or whatever you want on the forehead when being prayed for healing. That's not needed. And while I'm up here on my soapbox, I might as well also mention this. I've yet to read about someone praying for the sick and then during the prayer shouting the disease or sickness out of that person. I might be wrong, but I don't think things like disease and sickness flee because they're frightened of loud voices. First of all, our personal authority and power when praying for the sick and infirm doesn't frighten anything in the spiritual realm. But I can tell you, the Bible tells us that demons shudder at the mention of Jesus' name. So it makes sense to operate solely by the authority and under the power of Christ when praying for the sick. See, here's what I see. I didn't tell her ahead of time. So. You know, here's what I picture. I picture Jesus going to the infirm and just gently, "Father, by the authority you have given me, I speak sickness out of this body. Anything that's unclean, any evilness in this body, Lord, I speak it out. I speak healing and health into this body. Thank you, Father. Amen." Something as simple as that. And listen, God didn't give us any mystical words to say in Scripture about this either. Like, you have to say the exact terminology. There is no exact terminology. Listen, some little girl saying, "God, my mommy is sick. Would you please heal her?" You don't think that carries power to the throne room of God? Doesn't have to be the elders. And understand this, it's not like some power from God through the elders is conducted into these people. That's not it either. We got to get an understanding. We got to get a spiritual, a scriptural understanding of how this is supposed to work. We do what God's word tells us to do as a matter of obedience to the word of God. That is it. It is through our expressions of faith that God promises to respond. And we don't have to understand everything. But if Scripture lays for us a foundation, which it does, we are to follow it by faith and trust in it, and God is our salvation. Okay, next. Call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil. Why oil? What role does oil play in James's teaching for the church? Is it necessary? First of all, there is nothing magical about the oil. All right? I've had people tell me, oh, you get that oil from the Holy Land and it's gonna really work. Nah. No. There's no power in the oil. James is directing the church to use oil as an aid to their faith. Oil was used as a medicinal healing back then. That's what they used it for. It was an outward sign of the healing to be brought by God in response to the prayer. We use oil at the rock when we pray for healing for one reason. Scripture directs us to use it. I don't need to know anything else. Next, although it's not specifically mentioned in these verses of Scripture, when praying for the sick, Jesus and his disciples would most often accompany their prayer with the laying on of hands. Take a look at Luke 4. At sunset, the people brought to Jesus all who had various kinds of sickness, and laying his hands on each one, he healed them. Now, throughout the book of Acts, after Jesus had ascended into heaven, his apostles, in effect, became his hands, didn't they? In Acts 9, Ananias was directed by God to lay his hands on Paul 3 days after that Damascus experience. He did it to restore his sight. Paul's hands then, in turn, became God's means for extraordinary miracles. Take a look at Acts 28. This is Paul doing this. His father, meaning this chief official from the island of Malta, he was sick in bed, suffering from fever. Paul went in to see him, and after prayer, placed his hands on him and healed him. Now, again, why do we do this? Well, we do it because Scripture shows us Jesus did it. His disciples did it. He calls us his disciples, right? Why wouldn't we then do it? We go to Hampton Woods once a month, these elderly people. Many of them are very sick. And if you just go to one of these people and you just hold their hands or you just place your hands on their face or on their shoulders, they respond in such a positive way to that. There is something cathartic about laying hands on someone. Not putting your hands on them to move them around like they're so used to, but just gently putting your hands on them. So let's understand. Are we called to pray for the sick? Yes. So then, what is it that keeps us from then praying for each other's sicknesses? Right? Michelle got sick this week. I'm like, you got to get to the doctor. I'm like, you're praying about healing, Reed. Right? You're gonna be preaching on it. Go pray with your wife. Why wouldn't we do that? I mean, don't skip going to the doctor. I'm not telling you that. But why would you not rely upon the power that God has given you? Here's the reason why we don't do it. We don't do it because of the prospect it might not work. It's true. Take a look at James 1:6. But when he asks a person of prayer, he must believe and not doubt. We're worried, if we have a healing service, nobody gets healed. Oh, it's a failure. Listen, it's not up to me. right? If I believe God has given us this time to do what we're supposed to do, it's up to Him. I'm just trusting in it. And listen, I want you to know this. There is no magical guarantee that if all these steps are followed, that every person prayed for or any person prayed for will be made physically well. And that's not me saying that out of lack of faith or to cover my bases. I don't need my bases covered if I'm doing something that is already covered by the book. So I'm not going to worry about it. Plus, it's not up to me, is it? You better be thankful it's not up to me. It's up to Him. He's the sovereign one. He's in control of everything. You know, God identifies who He is by what He does. And here's what He says His name is in Exodus. He says, I am the Lord who heals you. When we translate that, that's Jehovah Rapha. I am the Lord, Jehovah Lord, who heals you. Rapha, I am Jehovah Rapha. How could God express His desire more clearly than to identify Himself by the name, I am the Lord God who heals you? Not only does it convey His will, it's His very name. Healing is who He is, and healing is what He does. So then why are some prayers remedied by prayer and with healing, and others not? I wish I had that answer. But I do have this answer. It falls under the sovereignty of God. I can tell you this. It is within the will of God that He does it, that He heals. I just know if someone is sick, the Bible says for the church to pray for them, and that's what we're going to do. One more thing before we do. There was a Roman centurion, a Gentile, who taught us a great lesson of what true faith looks like. Matthew 8. When Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to Him asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed and in terrible suffering. Jesus said, I will go and heal him. The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. Overall, the Bible presents a realistic view about healing. God has promised healing to His children, total healing. Healing of body, of mind, and soul. Take a look at 1 Peter 2:24. He Himself, Jesus, bore our sins in His body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By His wounds, we have been healed. You know, if you have confessed Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're healed. You're healed. This is not God's kingdom. You're not going to be physically healed for eternity, now, today. No. Jesus said, my kingdom is from another place. So the eternal healing of being with Him forever is all that is necessary for our lives to give us peace and joy and comfort right now. Jesus is a compassionate God. And He wants us, through His word and by His model, to pray for one another. So that's what we're going to do. Now, our elders are in here, and they have oil with them. Our three pastors are here. We got oil with us. So we're going to stand, and we're going to sing right now. We're going to worship God in unison. And at any moment during that song, the beginning, whatever, I want any of you who are looking to be healed to come forward or to go wherever the elders, they're going to be standing up so you can go to them and you can pray with them. You can pray with others. You have the Holy Spirit. If you got the Holy Spirit, you got everything I got. Trust me, right? And if you know somebody that is not here, that's why I read the centurion. You can come and ask for prayer for them. And if you're watching, you can join with us in unity, right? We got the same spirit. Now, in your bulletin, there are scriptures. There are healing scriptures. And so once we sing this song, you're welcome to sit back down. And those that would want healing, those that desire it, or those that want it for someone else, just start coming forward or to the sides or to the back, wherever the elders are at, and we'll pray with you. And then I don't even know how this is going to conclude. I'm just going to leave it up to God. But I would say spend some time in prayer of people you know, and there's everyone in here knows somebody that needs healing. And it doesn't have to just be physical. It can be mental. It can be emotional, spiritual. Just spend some time. Would you stand with me as in unity we sing to the Lord and prepare our hearts and minds for what He's about to do?
God for us, nothing could come against, no one could stand between us. God with us, God for us, nothing could come against, no one could stand between. When the weight of life begins to fall, on the name of Jesus I will call. For I know my God is in control, and His purpose is unshakable. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I'm casting out all fear, for Your love has set me free. My hope will always be in Your promises to me. Yeah. Oh. As I walk into the days to come, I will not forget what You have done. For You have supplied my every need, oh, and Your presence is enough for me. Yes. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see, my hope will always be Your promises to me. I'm casting out all fear, for Your love has set me free. My hope will always be in Your promises to me. Oh. You will always be more than enough for me. For me, nothing's gonna stop the plans You've made, nothing's gonna take Your love away. You will always be more than enough for me. You will always be more than enough for me. Lift Your voice. You will always be more than enough for me. Nothing's gonna stop the plans You've made. Nothing's gonna take Your love away. You will always be more than enough for me. Oh, You will always be more than enough for me. You will always be more than enough for me. Nothing's gonna stop the plans You made. Nothing's gonna take Your love away. You will always be more than. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see, my hope will always be in Your promises to me. Now I'm casting out all fear, for Your love has set me free. My hope will always be in Your promises to me. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what. Casting out all fear, for Your love to set me free. My hope will always be.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression. I speak Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in Thank you. shed the darkness and bathe in your light. And I recount every blessing, the words you spoke that bring me new life. And I am reminded from where you have brought me and where you have placed me for today. And I won't forget that your hand will sustains me through the way. And I will wait on you, Lord. I will wait on you, Lord. And all the burdens that I've carried, they are heavy, oh, too heavy to hold. Yeah, but there's a river, yeah, there's a sunrise, yeah, there's a new day, and it's bringing new life. I am reminded from where you have brought me and where you
I need you, oh, I
sin runs deep. Your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Answers far and wide, but I know can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call. His heart is good, he is all.